Okay, so good morning. My name is Marco, and I'm going to present about ICTP, ICT, and Internet of Things. So my background is a telecommunication engineer. That is where I do my, you know, research, and I want to tell you something about ICT. So just few slides about my organization. I know some of you already know ICTP. I saw a bug coming from ICTP. ICTP stands for International Center for Theoretical Physics. It's a center which was funded by Abdus Salam, Nobel Prize in Physics in 79. He founded the center in 64 in a place called Trieste, which is in the northeastern part of Italy. He found the center in Trieste because at that time Trieste was on the boundary between Western Europe and the Eastern Bloc. So it was a place where people from, you know, Russia and the US could meet and do physics together. It's an international organization administered by UNESCO and by the Atomic Agency. What do we do? ICTP is a center which is managed by a few scientists, about 30 permanent scientists, where we organize research, of course, workshop, conferences, training activities. And the motto of the center is that scientific thought is the common heritage of mankind. So Abdus Salam said that, you know, you can have different religions, different languages, different political views, but when you're talking about equations, you know, physics or math, we're talking the same language. So ICTP is a place where people come and do research together. We organize more than 60 activities every year. So, you know, every week there's one or more activities going on. There's a way to visit the center if you're a senior scientist. You can become an associate, meaning that ICTP will provide you a grant to come to the center every year for a couple of months to carry out your research, then you go back home. If you're a young scientist, there's, you know, possibilities for your young scientists. So, you know, check the website to see what's going on. We had more than 120,000 visitors since 64. There's about 6,000 people coming every year to ICTP for training activities. So again, 30, you know, resident scientists and 6,000 people coming every year. And here is the geographic distribution. You see it's, I would say, equally distributed. So there's people from, you know, from the West, from industrialized countries, from the South, from developing countries. They all come to ICTP to carry out research. So have a look. The website is ictp.it. And again, there's many opportunities there. Getting back to what I do, I'm the coordinator of a lab which is named after Guglielmo Marconi, Nobel Prize in Physics again, and inventor of the radio. Our topic is telecommunication and ICT for development. So it's a small group in a theoretical physics center which helps universities and scientific institutions to get better internet connectivity. Okay, so to connect to the internet or to connect devices to the internet, as you will see. We do research. We're a research organization, so we need to publish papers. But we have a kind of different model compared to normal academic institutions, I would say, or traditional academic institutions. In fact, we have three pillars. One is research, the other one is training, outreach, and the other one is deployment. Of course, to, you know, assist universities in getting better connectivity, you need to carry out research. You need to go, you know the best and latest technologies. But you need to test these technologies. So they need to be appropriate to the places where you're, you know, working. And of course, you need to train people. If you don't train people, you only deploy stuff, and then there's a lack of maintenance. So these three components go together in our lab. So I start from training. I think we already said that yesterday, how important is training in, you know, any kind of project. And in case of wireless, on internet connectivity, it's even more important. So when we started, I would say about, you know, 20 years ago, equipment was really expensive. So you could train people about, you know, wireless connectivity, how to use wireless to connect your university to the internet, but then the equipment wasn't that good. It was, you know, so and so. and it was really expensive. So you used to train people at ACTP, then they went back home, and they send emails saying, you know, we need your help to buy equipment. So let's move forward 20 years. Now things are completely different. So the price of equipment is not an issue. These things are incredibly cheap, incredibly cheap. So if you want to set up a, you know, Wi-Fi link to connect you know, buildings or, you know, institutions or, you know, weather stations, the price of equipment is nothing. This is even old. It's like $50 now. Every university can, you know, afford that. That's not an issue. Performance is incredibly good. Again, this is maybe 1 year old. Now it's more like half a gig. So connecting a building, which is, you know, 10, 20 kilometers far away from this building, will cost you $50. And you will get the same performance of having a cable. So it's really, really good. So this is not an issue. An issue is that you need to know how to do it. Okay, so training is really important. So we organize training activity. This is at ACTP in Trieste. You see, you know, some ladies here building antennas with low-cost stuff. This is a NeuralCAN, maybe, you know, $2. But you can set up 10-kilometer links with this very basic technology. So people learn that technology is something that you can do. You cannot only buy it from, you know, the US or Europe, but you can actually do stuff if you know how to do it. Of course, being ACTP International, you have people from all over the world. This guy's from Nepal, this guy's from Tanzania, this guy's from Malawi. They all work together to set up links and learn how to do it. But of course, we do activities all over the place. We had more than 40 activities just in Africa. We did the first wireless link in Africa, that was in Nigeria in the early 90s. This was an activity in Senegal, just as an example. We had activities on islands. This is in Micronesia, in the Pacific. We connected schools using, again, low-cost equipment, $50 radio link, and solar panels. So completely sustainable, even from the energy point of view. All this material, you can, of course, come to ACTP. You can ask for training in your, you know, institution, but there is also books. We, you know, wrote a book about wireless networking in the developing world. This is available in a number of languages: Spanish, French, Arabic, Portuguese, Indonesian. You know, they're translating it in so many languages. This again is now 4 million downloads, so lots of people using this book. It's on the fourth edition. Again, free information on the web. This is the Arabic version, just as an example. But I said that deployment is important. So we want to install stuff. We like to go on masts and, you know, install wireless equipment to learn how to, you know, how to do that. An example, this is in Malawi. They, using a technology that I will present in a few slides, they wanted to connect a number of institutions in Zomba, in the southern part of Malawi. So there was a school, there was a GPS station, seismological department, you know, Malawi, prone to earthquakes. This department was not connected to the internet. So they had a USB stick, they would save data every day. There was one guy, you know, picking the data, bringing it to an internet point. They wanted this data to be online in real time. Just to give you an example, this is my, you know, colleagues installing antennas. This is not the cheapest equipment, but it was appropriate for that specific condition. Team coming from, this guy's from Venezuela, from Italy, this guy's from the UK, Malawi, and that's myself. And you see, this is really, you know, I would say hard and hands-on work. So testing stuff, installing antennas, finding the best solutions. This was, in fact, there was an airport where they have some weather station that wanted to be online. Again, installing antennas on the roof. And the whole thing was done in 1 week. So it's really fast deployment. That's the advantage of wireless compared to wired connectivities. You just install things, and in a few days, you're done. It's not a big issue. And this is the final result, doctors having internet connectivity in hospitals, which didn't even have phones. and this was a side effect of our connectivity in Malawi. This is the GPS station, which again, finally was able to send data on the internet in real time. Another example, completely different situation, but I think quite interesting. This was in Senegal, you know, a university in Dakar. Huge number of students, they're talking about 80,000 students. They had 4 ADSL lines. So really slow connectivity, you know, painfully slow. But 3 kilometers from the university, they had fiber. So super fast, super cheap. The issue is, how do you dig 3 kilometers in the, you know, city center of Dakar? That would cost $100,000 and would take about 2 years. So really long process. So that's painful, you know. You have 80,000 students, you have internet, you know, a couple of kilometers far away. How do you, you know, help them? Well, you can help them with wireless. You can nowadays set up wireless links, which are powerful as fiber, and that's really cheap. It took 4 days to, you know, build a tower on the roof, buy the equipment, align it in the proper way, and get the university connected to fiber. So now they're spending like a tenth compared to the 4 ADSL lines to get a gigabit connectivity. So, you know, state-of-the-art connectivity. The price of the equipment, $1,000 for the whole link. So it's, again, really, really cheap. That's not, I mean, price is not the issue. The issue is that you need to know how to do it. And this is the result. We're, you know, pinging some site in Europe, full speed. You're now connecting to fiber. You can download the data we were downloading yesterday, you know, the weather data. You can download it, you know, in a few seconds instead of, you know, half an hour. Final result, head of computer science department, really happy. Research, I said, we're a, you know, research organization. We need to carry out research. If you don't publish, you perish. So that is what we normally do. Our research is, of course, you know, collaborative. We're not really interested in publishing things by ourselves. So we work with a lot of scientists from a number of African countries to present the results and, you know, to study these new technologies and, you know, to present it to the so-called ICT4D academic community. So one technology, the one I was talking about in Malawi, I think could be interesting for your country as well. And this is called TV white space. It's something quite new, which has a lot of potential in many countries. So these pictures shows the spectrum allocation in the US. So, you know, each chunk of spectrum is devoted to something specific. You know, air traffic control, or, you know, TV broadcasters, or, you know, Wi-Fi. The Wi-Fi we have here is a small chunk of the spectrum here. There is one opportunity which came from going from analog TV to digital TV. There is a chunk of spectrum devoted to analog TV, but as you know, most African countries are moving to digital TV, and they're using a much narrower, you know, space for the digital TV. So that spectrum, which is now left idle, going from analog to digital, can be used for telecommunication. Okay? So with the Wi-Fi that we're using here, we have a really, really small chunk of frequencies. But going from analog TV to digital TV, we have a broad number of frequencies, lot of space. And the advantage of these frequencies is that penetration is much, much bigger than if you use microwave. So the red spot here shows you the coverage in a specific place using 5 gigahertz, so using kind of Wi-Fi that we have here. It's really limited. So what happens if we use these TV frequencies? So for example, 470 megahertz, it's much, much broader. So you can imagine this is like having an access point covering, you know, large part of this island, only with one access point. Nowadays, we have one access point here, and we're barely covering this room. So this is a huge opportunity. And some countries are picking this up instance, Malawi, Mozambique, we have been working, you know, Ecuador in Latin America. So even if they haven't gone from analog to digital, they still have some idle frequencies. And we measured that, you know, spectrum, that frequencies. We went to the regulator and say, hey, come on, this frequency is not used in your country. Why can't we use it to connect, you know, schools or hospitals or, you know, weather stations? And that was, you know, what we did in Malawi. Another advantage of these lower frequencies is that you can have so-called non-line of sight. So if you have a small hill or a small mountain, you can still connect point A to point B, even if you don't have line of sight. So you can imagine, again, huge advantage. You don't need to go on the top of the mountain to set up your mast. You're saving a lot of money. As I said, this is an example of Malawi. This shows a specific frequency, 546 megahertz, and there is a color code. So you see it's used here, but in this part of the country, not used at all. So again, we went to the regulator and said, why don't we use TV white space here? It's not used. No one is using it. And you can, again, connect schools and, you know, scientific devices with very little cost. Talking about, you know, connectivity and islands, this is what we're doing with Joseph and with UNECA. So we're trying to, you know, train people and to come up with projects and ideas on how to use this low-cost technology to connect, you know, weather station and, you know, institution. So this is a training course we had last year in September with people from Mauritius, Seychelles, Comoros, Cabo Verde, and Guinea-Bissau. Getting back to a specific case, Mauritius, this is an exercise we did to measure this TV white space. And again, it's color code. Everything below, I would say, minus 90 is available. Okay? So here you have number of measurements, here you have frequencies, and you see that most of it is blue. It's not blue because of the, you know, sea, but it's blue because it's available. So only these kind of pink points are busy. And this is done on a car moving through Mauritius. So you see that even these pink places, dots, it's not everywhere. So in specific place, that's available. But look at what happens here between, instead, 600 and 800 megahertz. Almost through the whole country, that's available. And again, that could be used to connect scientific instruments or, you know, weather station. Getting back to Mauritius, just because we were there a couple of months ago, this is a simulation on how you can connect specific places in Bigara Tower and the Met Office in Vacoas using these, you know, $50 links. So these links are feasible. It's quite simple to connect places. This is another one to connect a weather station. So takeaways from this first part of my presentation is that we will be happy to help you solve connectivity issues. Really, that's, you know, our job. So if you have connectivity issues, just, you know, get in touch and we can help. We do research, so we're interested in that. Capacity building is very important. That's the most important thing. Cost of equipment, again, is not an issue. The issue is you need to know how to set up these links. And in some cases, this new technology, TV white space, can be used. The advantage, again, is that lower frequencies, better penetration, and better penetration with rain. I don't know if you ever experienced what happens if you have a Wi-Fi link and it rains. Wi-Fi doesn't penetrate on wet leaves. So if you have a tree, you know, in your link, there is no way, if it rains, you get your Wi-Fi link. It just, you know, drops connectivity. If you use this TV white space, just think about TV at home, you can go through rain and through wet trees. Not an issue at all. So of course that's a big advantage if you have some, you know, weather station or any scientific device, you want it to go through rain. Okay, second part of my presentation about the future. So what's, you know, Wi-Fi, this, you know, links, as I said, low-cost devices, that's easy, you can do it. that's already, you know, established technology. Let's talk about the future. The future is something called Internet of Things. This is the future of, you know, computer science and of, you know, a lot of communications. So the vision for this IoT was presented the first time in 2004 by a guy called Kaller from Berkeley University. So he had a paper where he plotted on this axis number of people per computer, and on this axis is time. So he said, you know, let's start, you know, 60s and 70s. So 60s and 70s, we used to have one computer, a mainframe, and you had many people working on the same computer. Okay? So many people, one computer. Finally, in the 80s, we had the PC, the personal computer. So that's finally, you know, your own computer. You have one person per computer. So this is the logarithmic, so you have zero here. Okay, so let's plot this. Now let's move to year 2000. People now have a desktop computer, they have a laptop, and maybe they had a PDA. So let's plot this here. Let's move, you know, 2010. So how many devices do we have now? Well, we have, you know, laptops, we have a desktop, we have a mobile phone, maybe we have two mobile phones, and maybe you have a tablet, you have a phone, where, you know, a wearable, a watch. So now you have many devices per person. And in fact, when you switch on your car, you activate almost 100 microprocessors in the car. So again, if you plot that, you see that there is a trend here. And the trend shows that in the future, like nowadays and in next years, you're going to have many devices per person. So many sensors, many microprocessors, a lot of microprocessors in the environment, okay? This thing, this so-called Internet of Things, you know, there's a big hype now about IoT. In fact, normally I show the latest news. I didn't do this time, but there's news all the time about big companies, Microsoft, you know, Cisco, Ericsson, Nokia, you know, you name it, they're all doing Internet of Things. So if you look at number of searches per day on this term, you see that after 2013, it went, you know, up the ceiling. And, you know, this in 2015, nowadays it's going to be here because they're unbelievable. If you look at how many people talk about IoT on social media, this is the hashtag IoT on Twitter, and there is again about 1,000 tweets per hour. So I don't know how many tweets per second that use that hashtag IoT. So again, lots of people talking about projects, ideas, you know, new devices, news. Lots going on in this field. This is a slide talking about the number of these devices. There is, you know, 2014, there were about 2 billion connected devices connected to the internet, shipped in 1 year. And this is one of the most conservative slides. They say that in 2020, there's going to be 8 billion. Cisco is talking about 20 billion devices. And, you know, now they're talking about 30 billion devices, you know, huge numbers. So what we're seeing now is just the tip of the iceberg. There's a lot going on down here. The fields are going to be, you know, consumer application, building infrastructure, cities, and so on. So what is this IoT about? IoT is not the technology. We're not very much interested, you know, in the gadgets that you can deploy. But it's about providing value for people. And I would say that IoT, at least in my vision, is about, you know, things, the gadget, internet, connectivity, and data. So they all work together in some way to provide value for people. So new capabilities, new services, new experiences, business model, and so on. So let's start by showing what these things are, Internet of Things. These things are, they're called nodes, of course, and they're, in the vision, those are very small devices. You see, as small as a penny, something that you cannot even see in the environment. Maybe, you know, a device which is put on a chair to see how many people are sitting in this room, to you know, adjust air conditioning. If there's few people, you know, you don't need the air conditioning that much. The room is full, you need more air conditioning. So it's really small devices that you don't even see in the environment. Being so small, they're really limited in terms of CPU power. Those are computers, but they're really low power computers. Memory is limited, few kilobytes. Bandwidth, of course, is limited. You're only sending, you know, someone is sitting on the chair or it's not. So it's not multimedia, it's not internet as we know it. It's a small chunk of information. And power consumption is critical. So if you have 20 billion devices, you don't want to be replacing 20 billion batteries, right? So you want the battery to be lasting 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. So to have your embedded chair, which, you know, you don't really need to remove the battery for the whole lifetime of the chair. And of course, you know, from the engineering point of view, developing such a device is not trivial. So this is why, you know, people are struggling and are still carrying out research in this field. What can you measure? So that is the node, is the, you know, microprocessor. What about, you know, measurements? There is really, you name it. I mean, you can measure like presence, proximity, like in the case of the chair. You can measure velocity, temperature, really easy. Now, you know, a temperature sensor is, you know, fraction of a dollar. Humidity, sound, vibration, chemical, gases, that is a bit harder, flow, you know, leaks, water leaks, and magnetic present, acceleration, like what you have in your phone, optical ambient light. So huge range of sensors, which of course range from, you know, fraction of a dollar, temperature and humidity, to, you know, tens of dollars for chemicals and gases, or, you know, leaks and so on. So if you think about the applications, you know, huge number of applications, really, you know, sky's the limit on what you can measure with, you know, all these sensors. Internet, this all relies on, you know, the internet. Well, IoT is, I would say, I would say technology agnostic. So I will give you an example. Let's say you buy this intelligent chair, or how people call it, a smart chair, which you install at home. What kind of connectivity do you have at home? You normally have Wi-Fi, okay? So this needs to be Wi-Fi, you know, enabled in a way. Let's go to something more, you know, familiar, maybe a weather station deployed somewhere in Seychelles. What do you have? You probably have, you know, 3G or 2G network, so you're probably going to use mobile connectivity. What happens if you have a weather station on a remote island? Well, maybe you can even have satellite connectivity. Satellite connectivity is not that expensive nowadays. It's, you know, comparable to SMS, not expensive at all. Let's go on the other side. Let's say you want to deploy your network of, you know, pollution sensors. Well, in that case, you want to investigate this specific technology built for IoT, something called Zigbee or 6LoWPAN. They're, you know, protocols which are designed to use as little, you know, battery power as possible. So those are specific for IoT. We said data. Why is data important? Well, data is the most important, you know, result of an IoT network. And this is an example about electricity. And I think it shows quite well what, you know, why IoT is important. So nowadays, you measure how much power you use at home, and you get your bill. That's all. You don't have any information about who is using, you know, how much power. You only have one value. In the future, you will have these small chips in every single plug, you know, in the wall. And in that case, you have a very detailed information about how much power are the lights using, the fridge, computer, TV, and kitchen. Even more, you can dig down to, you know, the details. You know, the fridge you have in the garage, you know, you have number of computers, you know, number of TV sets, how much each single TV set is using. So from all this, you know, rich information, you can you know, find out that your, you know, kitchen fridge is using most of the power. So maybe you can adjust that, okay? So you're going from, you know, one data to, you know, dozens or even hundreds of, you know, data sources. And this is, I would say, only getting data about the energy. What about the next step? Can you have your devices, you know, talk to each other so that you can save energy? And this is, I think, shown quite well in this example. This example is about an alarm clock. So nowadays, an alarm clock is not that intelligent, right? It knows the time, you set up an alarm, switches on, that's all. It's a dumb device. In the future, with all these intelligent devices, the alarm clock can become smart. And for instance, your meeting was pushed back 45 minutes. You have that information from email, so that is sent to the alarm clock. But the car, at the same time, knows that it needs gas to make it to the train station. So the car, dumb device, sends information to the alarm and says, you know, I need gas and I need 5 minutes, you know, to be filled up. Then, you know, there's a traffic jam, 15 more minutes, information coming from the internet, sent to the alarm clock. The train is late. So you get that information from the train station, goes again to the alarm clock, and the alarm clock takes a decision, hopefully an intelligent decision. It says, okay, you know what? You can wake up 15 minutes later. So the coffee machine can be activated 15 minutes later. Or if you live in Canada, you're, you know, you need to defreeze your car, you know, some minutes later, you know, later. So you see, some, you know, dumb device becomes a smart device because of all this information coming in. As you can imagine, this is the vision. There's many issues involved in that. One is security, of course. What happens if your friend sends you, you know, wrong information, says that the meeting is late, the meeting is not late, you show up late, and you get fired, you know? Or, you know, what happens, it's, you know, you can imagine many, many issues involved in this, but this is the kind of vision. When you're talking about data, this is a slide that, you know, people usually smile about. We're now talking about zettabytes, 10 and 21, but people are already planning, you know, yottabyte, brontabyte, geobyte. Huge amount of data, huge amount of data. And just to give you an example, nowadays, in the zettabyte world, we're only using less than 1% of all this data. 1%. Can you imagine when we have 20 billion devices? We're going to be in the brontabyte era, be, you know, how much of all this data are we going to analyze? This is a huge field and, you know, completely open. I think it's really interesting. Okay, so, as I said, we said it was 4 billion devices, right, shipped in 2014. So some of these devices, or many of these devices, are already sending data on the internet. So information you can download for free and use for free. And there is a site called thinkful.com, which is kind of a Google for sensors that publish data on the internet. So every single dot here is one data source, which you can, you know, download data from and use data from. So guess what? You have many dots in the US, you have many dots in Africa, in Europe, but you have very few dots in Africa. And most of these dots are from the coast. So this is to say that, of course, there is, you know, still lots to do, and the same is in Latin America. So very few sensors and very few open data available from the continent. So this is, of course, where ICTP can help, and that's, of course, our interest. So how can we make sure that you have more available data here? If you wonder why you have all these dots in the sea, those are ships. Ships that, you know, send data on the internet about, you know, weather, about water, and so on. This is the number of sensors we have in Trieste, just as an example. Not that many, but still, you can find some information. One of the fields that came out as something useful when we had our training courses on IoT was, of course, weather information. And I digged out that, you know, this from another presentation, but they were saying that in Africa, there is a one WMO station every 27,000 square kilometers. So there is about 1,100 WMO weather station, you know, reporting to WMO. If you look at Germany, really small country, of course, compared to Africa, there is one weather station every 1,000 kilometers, square kilometers, and there is 300. So this is a third of the whole African continent. So there is, of course, this is an issue. There is a lack of weather stations. And to kind of, you know, train people about this new technology and the possibility it offers in, you know, our scientific domains, we organized a number of workshops starting almost 10 years ago in African countries. We had three workshops in Trieste. We had workshops in Latin America and in Asia. Some of these workshops led to some interesting research. Again, this is I think 2010, so ages ago in terms of technology. But this was about weather stations in Kenya. There was a researcher, he said, you know, instead of having big and expensive weather station, can we do something comparable using this low-cost device? And this, of course, was research, so, you know, you don't really know about the results, and it's going to be limited in number of, you know, devices, but this is what she came up with, measuring temperature, pressure, humidity, and light, I believe. And she deployed a number of those in Kenya for her research. Other results, this was Indonesia. They were really interested in measuring radiation. So they developed, during our workshop, a low-cost radiation sensor. This had a GPS on board, so people could move with this radiation sensor and produce a kind of radiation map. Talking about radiation is, you know, gamma radiation or nuclear radiation. Another case was in Benin. This was quite successful. We won a prize for this. It was about air quality sensors. So a big issue in Benin is air quality. They buy fuel in Nigeria, then they kind of mix it, and it's a very polluted place. So they wanted to measure air quality. They had no air quality sensors, calibrated ones, so they wanted to have some information about air quality. So they came up with a prototype, which is this one, which looks like a prototype with some tape, has a solar panel and some, you know, air quality sensors on board. This would send data using 3G networks, so you had real-time data every couple of minutes about air quality. Another example is in Thailand at AAT. You see they were, again, building prototypes. This is 2 years ago. And the application they had in mind was about a fishery, about fish farming. So they wanted to measure in these fish farms, like water temperature, you know, dissolved oxygen, and turbidity of water. And they wanted to relate that information to number of fishes they would grow. Again, this is something that you don't have that kind of information if you don't have a kind of IoT, you know, network. Again, very low cost devices. The whole node is maybe $100. So you can deploy many different ponds, and they even publish the results. It was quite interesting. IoT has not only scientific, you know, information, like in the case of fish, but it also has economic impacts. And this is an example, not long ago, it was, I think, last year, yeah. So IBM bought this company called weather.com for $2 billion, huge amount of money. So I said, why does, you know, IBM care about weather? I mean, what's a, you know, business model? And the business model for IBM is clear. So they can sell that weather information to a number of customers. One being airlines. If you have detailed, you know, weather information coming from this IoT devices. You have, you know, thousands of IoT devices, very detailed weather information. You can sell that information to airlines. So they don't have delays, they save fuel. So that's one model. The other one is for insurance companies. If you have a very bad weather coming, insurance can ask people to, you know, move their car, for instance, so it's not damaged. So they save lots of money. So IBM, again, invested $2 billion to, you know, get more detailed weather information for weather.com. This information about Africa, this has been presented at the Davos meeting, you know, all these economies and so, and they say that if they have Internet of Things, Kenya is going to grow, you know, the GDP 25%. Huge amount. I don't know if it's realistic or if it's a hype, but anyway, people are thinking about, you know, economic growth given by all these sensors that can optimize agriculture, you know, industry and so on. So we said scientific impact, economic impact. Of course, it's also social impact. This is one of the first network we set up. This is again in Malawi, measuring water quality. There was no information about water quality. They would measure it, you know, by hand, getting the results after a few days. And nowadays they can have automatic readings coming in every few minutes. So if water quality is bad, people stop, you know, drinking that water, and of course it helps a lot in terms of social. So takeaways, IoT is here to stay. All the big companies are investing in IoT. It's, you know, no doubt that we're going to hear about IoT in the future. We have been working in IoT since 2004. Again, we're really keen to work in IoT deployments and research, and weather came out as one of the most important applications. And now to finish, just, you know, two or three slides about something that is even more interesting for you. And it's how IoT and, you know, weather information, I mean, new ideas and products in this field. So this is something really new, came out just, you know, a few months ago. It's a protocol called LoRa. You're not interested in the details, but you're interested in the fact that they developed an industry standard that allows devices to communicate at a maximum distance of 20 kilometers, so very long range, for these, you know, small nodes, really small nodes. This one with the small antenna, which is, you know, few centimeters, can send data up to 20 kilometers. And this is a protocol which is designed for low power. So again, this device without the solar panel can probably live, you know, a couple of years, maybe 1 or 2 years without even having a solar panel, but with a very small battery. So this is a communication technology. So there's one company in the Netherlands that got in touch with us when we have been working with them already, and they developed a low-cost weather station. So this is the rain sensor they're using, called Rain-O-Matic, which they claim is based on the tipping bucket, self-emptying tipping bucket, and they say that they have, you know, 200,000 rain gauges in 41 countries. This is what they installed. And just to give you an idea of what they're selling, this is confidential, but I'm sharing it with you, you know, to get your feedback. So they have a kind of a node, a small device, which can measure TPH, temperature, pressure, humidity, with, you know, calibrated sensors. It uses this LoRa, so up to 20 kilometers. It uses this rain sensor, and it has a, you know, small solar panel, weatherproofing case. All the information is sent to a gateway, to, you know, this device, which collects information from the network. This one also has a solar panel, can be internet connected, or can send data through 3G. So even in a remote place, you can still send data. They have some cloud services to store all the data. And the cost for 25 stations is about €12,000. So that means that one station is about, you know, 500. It's about €500. If you buy 100, of course, the cost is even more limited, €250. So now we're going from, you know, professional calibrated weather station, which cost tens of thousands, to a new model where you have, you can have many weather stations in a region which still have TPH and they have rain, and they can survive with a small battery for a number of years. I'm not sure if that is of interest, but I think it's quite interesting, at least from my point of view. Another information before, you know, getting question, just to tell you how far this technology has gone, is about this Texas Instruments tag, which I have here. We were discussing yesterday about temperature, pressure, and humidity information. So when I started doing this IoT and sensor networks, the nodes were, you know, hundreds of dollars each. So this is a device produced by Texas Instruments, really small device, really small. It has a number of sensors. So let's start from here. It has a pressure sensor, ambient light sensor. You have digital humidity. You have 9-axis motion sensor, temperature sensor. If you look on the back, it has something else, magnet sensor, didn't have microphone. So this device, if you measure this data every second, so, you know, huge amount of data every second, the battery would last 2 years. And the price of this is about $20. So again, price is becoming, you know, not relevant anymore. In my short experience with IoT, I saw already a 10 times decrease in price. And, you know, this is available on the market. We're now testing that in ICTP and in a number of East African countries. The idea is to use this in a, you know, weatherproof, weatherproofing, you know, enclosure, and see how well calibrated are the sensors. But again, shows where we're heading, you know, $20 device with 12 sensors on board and, you know, 2 year battery life. And I think that's all from my side. If you have any question, I would be happy to answer.